Good morning and I welcome everyone to this, the 10th meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2021. I will be taking the chair for the first evidence session and the convener will join us for the second. Before I begin, can I remind members, witnesses and staff present that social distancing measures are in place in committee rooms and across the Holyrood campus. In addition, a face covering must be worn when moving around, exiting and entering the committee room, although they can be removed once you're seated at the table in the committee room. The first item on our agenda is to agree to take agenda items 4 and 5 in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Okay, agenda item 2 is the 2020-21 audit of the Crofting Commission. Can I welcome our witnesses this morning to the meeting? Bill Barron, Chief Executive, and Malcolm Matheson, Convener of the Crofting Commission. Can I invite Malcolm Matheson to make a short opening statement?
Okay, certainly. Good morning. Thank you for inviting us to give evidence to you about the Crofting Commission. As you know, our external auditors submitted a report to us at the end of May, which led to a Section 22 coming to yourselves in October. We welcomed the recommendations of the audit report and we immediately set about implementing them. The Crofting Commission's board and management and the sponsor team of the Scottish Government have united around delivering this plan. As of today, 33 of the 41 recommendations have now been implemented and two more may be signed off when the board meets tomorrow. The root of many of the recommendations was a lack of clarity about roles and relationships, some of this arising from, as you've heard before, some unusual legislation. We have, however, tackled this head-on, both by working with the Scottish Government to revise our framework document and also by securing joint training for commissioners, senior management and sponsor division. All of this has actually progressed incredibly well over the last 6 months. Now, Bill and I are here and we're very happy to address any questions you may have or any clarification that you require from Bill or I of what we've been doing over the last 6 months to ensure that the recommendations are in place, but more importantly, they're in place for the future. So if you'd like to ask us any questions, we're certainly more happy to help.
Thanks very much for that. I'll now open the session up to questions from members. If I can just start with a couple of questions. It's good to hear that you've actually made a lot of progress and that you've done 33 out of the 41 and hopefully another two tomorrow. Can I ask, the report raises some very significant concerns. Can you tell us the extent to which the issues raised in the report have impacted in the key services the Commission provides to the Crofting community?
I think Bill, from an operational perspective, I think Bill would probably answer these questions. From a board perspective, I think I can say it's focused the board into the roles and responsibilities within the Commission. I think it's focused that the board now understands what its responsibilities are. And I think it's now become clear what is operational and what is strategic within the board. And that's been very helpful to everyone. But operationally wise, Bill would be the best person to answer.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Of course, it's had an impact. You know, there's been a lot of senior management time diverted to thinking about these matters. But the staff and the middle managements of the Crofting Commission have progressed with performing to an exceptional level. And so the impact on that side of our work has been minimised. You'll be aware, I think, that in 2019-20, we met 13 of our targets, partly met one, and missed only one, which was about the extent of sickness absence among our staff, and there's absolutely nothing we could have done about that. And it's been picked up, I know, that in 2020-21, that picture did shift, so we met nine targets, we missed seven. But when you look at those targets, many of them were couched in terms of, let's see if we can do as well or better than last year. And of course, 2021 was the year of COVID, when, for example, grazings committees couldn't meet. We had issues with connectivity, we had issues with availability of our building, we had staff who weren't able to be present because they had caring commitments and so on. So it's not at all surprising that that performance measured in that crude way appears to have dipped. I can assure you that the staff back at the ranch are performing extremely well.
Thanks very much. There was in the report things that some of the roles were a bit blurred, so it's good that it's it's been clarified and they know what their roles are. So the report...
I'd just like to highlight that we have had the training sessions, which we've all attended, as I explained initially. And it's been, I think, now very clear as to where the roles and responsibilities are starting and finishing. And I think that's been a big step forward for the board and also for senior management and sponsor.
That's good to hear. Thank you. So the report states that there was excessive involvement by the board and the former convener in operational decision making and in matters that would typically be the responsibility of the senior management team, excluding the office tasks performed during the pandemic. Can you explain why the board and the former convener became involved with operational decision making?
The definition there is operational decision making. We were operating during a COVID period, and what the board did was gave out our board's telephone numbers to anybody in the Crofton community to contact us. And the reason is that staff were working from home. It was a new environment. Everybody was getting set up with both IT, etc. And the board said we would assist by answering any queries, if we could, from those within the Crofton communities. So the board at that stage did get involved in operational matters. The convener did, but we thought it was for the right reasons. And that was to try and assist Bill and his operational team. I think some of the comments about the previous convener and the role he was undertaking, I think, not quite correct. It was all done for the right reasons, and it was done very much to try and help Bill and his staff. But I think, retrospect, knowing what we know now, then yes, it possibly did veer into an operational matter.
And has that been changed now?
Absolutely. Totally. Well, there's not the same requirement. Home working is now up, it operates. Bill and his team have put in all the procedures. So there's no requirement for the board to be involved now. At the initial stages, the board felt it was the correct thing to do.
But now everybody's quite clear on what the roles and responsibilities are.
With regards to the board, I can certainly say yes, Bill could answer for himself and his management team.
Bill, do you want to come on?
Yes, I would echo what Malcolm said. We have had some constructive joint training about the divide between the roles of the board, the roles of senior managers, and the operational strategic split, as it were. It's quite clear which things are normally delegated to staff to lead on. It's also quite clear, and it's been made clear to us in the training, that the board are responsible for everything. So it's a question of judgment as to when they ask for more detail. But I'm absolutely clear that my convener understands how to work that judgment, and it's working exactly as it should.
Okay, thank you. Can I just ask what things aren't quite correct regarding the previous convener?
I think there is nothing in the report that's technically incorrect. Aspects of it, we as a board felt language was a bit emotive because the person was doing what he thought was the right thing. For example, taking a staff survey, the previous convener took off his chairs in the back of his Jeep round staff to help them when they were starting to work from home. And whilst he was there, you know, he'd ask a question, how are you, how's things, etc., etc. But when he conveyed it in writing, he put down he'd undertaken an unofficial staff survey. It wasn't necessarily that. It was more a case of trying to understand what was taking place. I think in the operational side, again, as I've explained, I think we were in a situation which nobody had experienced before. So the board were trying to assist, but if you like, technically, we did veer into operational matters. So there is nothing in the report which is technically incorrect, but we do feel aspects of it didn't take account of the situation at that point in time.
Right, okay, thank you. The report mentions operational matters before COVID, so are they still happening now, or has everything been changed post-COVID?
At the present minute, I think Bill's explained that with the training, there's a very clear distinction of what we as a board are responsible for. And I think there is now an understanding within the Commission, and I would say within the staff of the Commission as well, of the responsibility of the board.
Everybody's quite clear of their roles and responsibilities.
We should be after the training, yes, and I'm sure we are. And speaking on behalf of the other commissioners, we are certainly very clear now, yes.
Right. OK, thank you. Right, I'll move on to questions from the other members. So the first questions are on leadership and governance of the Crofton Commission. And Craig Hoy's got some questions on that.
Good morning, Mr Matheson and Mr Barron. The impression I'm getting from what you've said so far is that it's effectively what went wrong was circumstantial rather than systemic or attitudinal. But perhaps, Mr Matheson, if you could say, at what point did you get the impression that leadership and governance arrangements had broken down after a period of apparent stability?
I think one of the things was there was a lack of understanding amongst commissioners about the chief executive's roles and responsibilities. I think the understanding of the board was the chief executive reported to and was accountable to the board. And I think there's a couple of occasions arose, which is in the report, which we were not fully aware of. But it was only then that we probably appreciate fully the dual reporting that the chief executive had. And I think the biggest learning coming out of it is that within the new framework document, which we as a board will hopefully be signing off tomorrow, that's now clear that the chief executive is accountable to and reports to the board. So I think there was a lack of understanding about the roles and responsibilities prior to this report being made available.
And you... Sorry, Mr. Mark.
It might help just to go right back to the start of COVID. And an approach was made to myself from the Scottish Government to ask if they could borrow me for a few weeks to go and work on the care homes crisis. And that came, you know, hundreds of people were being moved around to do emergency jobs at the time. It was enormously pressured. But the confusion over my status, you know, was I a Scottish Government person on secondment? Was I a Scottish Government person appointed to the Crofton Commission? You know, what was I? And what happened was that the senior person in the Scottish Government and I both spoke to the then convener and said, what do you think? Could he be away for a few weeks? And Rod said, yes, obviously COVID is much the most significant issue affecting Crofters as well as everybody else just now. So it was agreed on that basis. What we didn't do was consult the whole board at that time, which with hindsight we should have done. I mean, obviously it was moving at great pace, but that, I think, was the first time that the board felt there's something a bit funny here about the way decisions are being taken without us being formally consulted.
And what was your response to the vote of no confidence, and what's your understanding as to why it's now been withdrawn?
So at the time of the vote of no confidence, I wasn't supposed to know that it had happened, in that they had written privately to Fergus Ewing. I discovered the basic content of that letter only when I saw a draft of the Deloitte report in around about March or April of this year. And it said things about my style of leadership, which I think were partly to do with a clash of cultures between, you know, I'm obviously steeped in the public sector, I've done 40 years of it for goodness sake, and my colleagues on the board come from a small business, private sector background. They are impatient for things to be fixed quickly. They are impatient of bureaucracy. And I think, you know, I've learned a huge amount from them. I relish that kind of challenge. But there is a little clash of cultures there, if I can say. I considered stepping down because, you know, you don't want to be working for a board that doesn't want you. But my staff, my senior managers who knew about it and those staff who guessed, were absolutely foursquare saying, no, things would be worse if I left. When it all came out to the point where we were able to talk about it, and the board actually spoke to me about it in June of this year, they said to me, look, the problem here is a constitutional one. It's not personal about you. It's about the way this thing works and fits together. And at that point, it was pretty clear to me that my stepping aside wouldn't fix the problem. So that's why I decided to carry on, to attend to delivering the business of the Crofton Commission and to working as closely as I could with my board colleagues to resolve these constitutional confusions, as it were. And I think The reason that the vote of no confidence was withdrawn a month ago was because we have worked through these constitutional confusions and there is now much greater understanding of the way these roles interact.
Fine.
Yeah, I absolutely concur. I think the issue the board had is that the board was under the impression the chief executive was accountable to and reported to the board. And as such, the board took the decision, well, why is the chief executive going off and doing other things and not telling us first? Yeah. And it was only when it became clear to us that it wasn't actually our responsibility to actually say yes or no for the chief executive going off to do other tasks. And I think over the last probably 5 to 6 months, the board and the chief executive has worked closer, I would probably suggest, than it's worked for many, many years, in actually delivering the recommendations. And I think also the board had private conversations with the senior management team, who are very, very supportive of the chief executive. And as such, we then felt that based on the changes that have taken place, the clarity of the roles, responsibility and our understanding, and also of the support that Bill has with his senior management team, that it was correct we actually withdraw our vote of no confidence.
Okay.
But initially it was purely down to the fact that we didn't feel that the chief executive was keeping the board fully informed, but subsequently we found out the reasons why.
I just want to go back to the opening statement in which you effectively said that COVID was the cause of this problem, but I'm getting the impression that there was a latent dysfunctionality that came to a head during COVID. Is that the right way of characterising
this? I said COVID was probably the reason for more operational involvement from commissioners. COVID wasn't the reason. You know, the roles and responsibilities existed prior to COVID, so it's not the reason. But in terms of the board getting more involved in operational matters, I think COVID was probably the main driver for that, yes.
You accept there was a weakness there beforehand?
Oh, yes, absolutely, yeah, absolutely.
So just looking forward, obviously, there is going to be an effort of rebuilding trust. From your perspective, Mr. Matheson, how are you going to do that?
Well, I think the first thing is we've been very, very open in all communications between the chief executive, myself, and I think, more importantly, between sponsor division, myself. So the commissioners get notes of every meeting I have with sponsor. They get notes of every meeting with the chief executive. They get the minutes of these meetings. We are now very, very open in the way that we ask our questions. So rather than maybe, if you can say, board members talking amongst themselves, if we want to ask a question, we're now very open and we're very detailed in the questions we ask. So I think there is a greater clarity in roles. But I think there is certainly over the last 6 months become a lot more openness in all aspects of the Commission, ranging from sponsor through board, through senior management, through the chief executive.
And is there now a more formal process that's been developed to ensure that the chief executive is held accountable for his performance to the board?
Yes, the framework document, which we hope to have approved tomorrow, now states that the chief executive is accountable to and reports to the board. And at each of the board meetings, the chief executive gives a verbal update to the board on everything that's taken place. And the board now receives a lot of facts and information which potentially it didn't receive before. Now, you know, there's a lot of information that comes to us that is purely for information only. We don't act on it. But it means we now are aware of what's happening within the organisation a lot clearer than we were before.
And do you think as a board that you're making the best use of the combination of appointed and elected members?
Yes. I think one of the issues with elected members, which we are trying to highlight just now and hopefully resolve, is I think there was a perception that elected members were there to represent their constituents. And as such, there is a possibility elected members can get involved in day-to-day operational matters. And within our website, we're being very clear for the next elections. Elected members are there to provide the Bill, his SMT, and also the government with the experience of crafting matters and crafting communities. So the split, I think the greater understanding of the role of an elected commissioner is very, very important. And I think that's something we're focusing on in the last couple of months, and it should come through. I think the appointed commissioners for skills and experience, which you may not get from elected ones, you may not. It's it depends who stands for election. So I think the split is good because you're bringing in specific skills that the commissioner may require.
And is there now a formal appraisal mechanism for board members?
Yes, it's already started. I can only do appraisals from when I took over as convener, which was July of this year. That process has now started. The initial documents have been out to each commissioner, which has to be back in by the first week of January. I then have the second and third week of January set aside for having my discussions with the commissioners. I will then document that. That then goes on to sponsor division. So that process is in place. That process has already started with the documents going out. And we also reviewed the appraisal documentation as well to make sure it was actually relevant for elected and appointed commissioners.
Ms. Barnard?
Yes, I'm aware of all of that. It's Malcolm's been supported in that by my board support expert, but also by the training that we've had. So, we're happy that we've got a proper process in there and that it's going to be fulfilled.
You said at the outset, obviously, that the training had taken place already. Is that an ongoing process? Will that be a continual process of training?
I think one of the biggest learnings from the training we've just undertaken is that that training should have happened when the new board was brought together, because the training we've had over the last 6 months has highlighted in a very detailed manner what's operational, what's strategic, what the board should get involved in, what the board shouldn't get involved in. And the training was such that the commissioners all felt that when the new board takes effect from April next year, that the training sessions we've just had, we want them within the first 6 months of the new board, because it's imperative that they understand right at the start of the tenure what their roles and responsibilities are. And unfortunately, I think, obviously, it's taken 5 years for us to get to that, so we want to do that very quickly now.
Well, let me just take a slightly different tack on that, because we did institute, we had 8 new members out of 9 in the space of 3 months in 2017, and that's a challenge for any board. We did institute a pretty heavy schedule of training, but we probably front-ended it too much. So there was a deluge of information coming to people who maybe didn't have any knowledge of how the public sector organisations operate. So I think we're now looking to do it in a more nuanced way, concentrating on a smaller number of key things up front and then taking a bit more time over some of the rest of it. Having said that, we're all hoping that there won't be the same extent of discontinuity at the next elections. Some of my colleagues stand again and are re-elected, then that obviously helps as well.
Fine. Thank you, Kevin.
Thank you. Before I move on to the next set of questions, could I ask if we could possibly get an update in writing on the framework that was agreed and also the further recommendations implemented after your meeting tomorrow?
Absolutely.
If you could update the committee in writing.
Once it's been signed off tomorrow by the board, we will certainly do that, yes.
Brilliant. Thank you. Right, the next set of questions is sponsorship arrangements between the Scottish Government and the Crofton Commission. And Colin Beattie's got some questions in that.
Thank you, Mayor. You know, before I get on to the sponsorship arrangements, it's easy when I'm sitting here actually to forget how serious the Section 22 report is. The impression I'm getting here is sort of, you know, nothing to see here, move on. It was just little technical hitches and so on, and we've sorted everything out and it's all cuddly again. But I come back to the fact this is an extremely poor report. And that extremely poor report is the responsibility of senior management, past and present. I expect senior management to have the skills that we and the knowledge and the commitment that we don't get into this sort of situation, that we should not have to be looking at these reports. And yet, here we are looking at it. Now, I realise that from your perspective, a great deal of work's probably been done. There's been changes to the board and everything. I'm concerned to ensure that we don't see the Crofton Commission in front of this committee again with the Section 22. I'm not really hearing that reassurance of the senior management skills, the assurance that we've got people in charge that actually are capable of managing this to an adequate level. We're told, for example, I think it was you, Bill, that said that there's extensive training given to the new board members and everything as they came in, 8 out of 9 having changed. But they have a responsibility, and they can't walk away from that responsibility. Whether they're elected or appointed or whatever, they have that responsibility, and they should have the skills. If they don't have the skills, then clearly they're unsuited to the job. Now, we have seen the results of what appears to be failure after failure in the management process. And that's why we got that Section 22. I'd be happy for you to comment, but we cannot walk away from the fact that this is a serious report with serious deficiencies. And it will take time for certainly us as a committee to understand and to accept that the changes that have been implemented are going to be a step change in this situation. But I think we're being maybe a little bit naive in just accepting that everything's been fixed, because there's no evidence of that at this point.
All I can say is the board, as it's constituted today, is totally committed to ensuring that the situation never arises again. You did make the comment about having necessary skills and experience. When there's 3 appointed commissioners, you can obviously get a skill set that you require. When there's 6 elected commissioners, what you have to work with is the individuals that's elected, and we've been very fortunate. We have a very, very capable group of elected commissioners, and I would hope going forward that's the same case. I think, as Bill has said, there was a lot of training took place at the start, and it was trying to understand the difference between a commercial environment and a more public environment. I think going forward, what this board has learned will be passed on to the next board. And myself and one of the other appointed commissioners, we are still here for another 3 years. So we will ensure that what's happened in the past, that lesson has been learned, will be carried forward into the future. And I do, Bill will speak for management, but I certainly think the relationship is a lot closer now than I've seen it in the 5 years I've been in the commission.
OK, we'll move on to safer ground, shall we? Sponsorship arrangements. Clearly there was serious concerns about how the sponsorship arrangement worked, and that came out in the report. How did it come about that the government's sponsorship division seemed to relate to the senior management team rather than the convener? How did that come about?
Thank you. Obviously, I can't comment for the previous convener, so I'm not aware of that relationship there. Bill could possibly update you.
So I think that probably does relate back to the predecessor board that were in post between 2012 and 2017. And there were, as you know, governance difficulties with that board towards the end of their term. I became chief executive initially on an acting basis 5 months before the election. And there were all sorts of discussions between me and Scottish Government about, how can we keep this organisation going? How are we going to restore the credibility with Crofters and so on? So we probably got into bad habits then of there being a strong connection between myself and the sponsor team. We did try to reset that when the new board came in. Rod McKenzie became convener. He was chalk and cheese different from his predecessor, and he started meeting with sponsorship with me and so on. But I think the relationship was already quite strong, and Rod probably felt that he was not entirely necessary there, and we didn't do enough to sort of strengthen that direct relationship between sponsor and the then convener.
Did the government sponsorship division comment at all on the unusual route of contact?
No, I suspect they were also caught up in the same mistake that I was, that, you know, having been through a very troubled time with the previous board, they were then also, you know, in a comfort zone of talking to a civil servant, and none of us spotted the importance of correcting that.
I think it was Malcolm touched on the current relationship with the sponsor division. Does it provide the support that's required now? Are you satisfied with that support?
From my personal angle, absolutely. I think the revised framework document, the major changes that we as a board wanted in that document, sponsor division were exceptionally helpful in making sure that it actually went through. I think the changes there, for example, myself as convener, along with Bill's direct report, now do appraisals. That didn't happen in the past. So the board had absolutely no input to that. So I have found that the sponsor division has been exceptionally helpful over the last 6 months. They have, any time we've asked for assistance or clarification, we've received it very, very quickly. And I do think I've experienced anyway very much an openness in the last 6 months as well. I can't comment, obviously, what transpired prior to that period of time, but from my position as convener, I'm very, very pleased with the support and openness that we have with sponsor division now.
And we should also note that sponsor division colleagues have been part of this joint training that we've been saying so much about. So that's been joint between board, management and sponsor.
OK. We've touched again on, in the course of the discussions about the use of Scottish Government staff, and including Chief Executive, they're provided by the Scottish Government on Scottish Government terms. I think virtually all your staff are actually seconded,
temps,
which is usual to that extent. What are the advantages and disadvantages of that?
So the main advantage is administrative convenience, that you know, other NDPBs of not totally dissimilar size to ours would have an HR team of maybe three staff. We don't have an HR team as such. We obviously look after the well-being of our people, but all of the pay negotiations, terms and conditions, you know, disciplinary arrangements, all of that is provided for us.
Couldn't you do the same thing simply by recruiting people on the same terms and conditions as the Scottish Government?
We could do, and then the other issue is that...
But you don't.
So when the Crofting Commission was formed out of the previous Crofters Commission, which was an agency, the proposal at that time was to put to move staff from Scottish Government, you know, being part of Scottish Government, as it were, for HR purposes, into the sort of normal arrangement for an NDPB. There was a backlash against that. I think there would have been considerable disquiet and probably quite a lot of losses of staff if we'd made that change at that time, and Parliament decided that it would leave the Crofting Commission the option of doing it either way.
Parliament decided?
It's in the Act.
OK. It's actually embedded in the Act that it's going to be Scottish Government staff?
It's in the Act that says that the Crofting Commission may use its own staff or may use staff provided by the Scottish Government.
So it provided an option?
Yes.
OK.
Can I also just clarify again from the revised framework document? In that document it says that any subsequent chief executive may or may not be a government appointee, or sorry, a secondment from the Scottish Government. So, you know, within the framework document, it gives the board the opportunity, if it requires to do so, of recruiting outside of that area.
I don't think that's quite right, Malcolm. I think the appointment has to be a Scottish Government appointee, but the recruitment can be from wherever.
Correct. The appointment has to be approved by the Cabinet Secretary, but from a board perspective, the board can look at employees out with of a government.
But it never has?
To date, it hasn't been able to know. The framework document has only been altered to reflect that just now.
OK. Now, just to go a little bit to the side on this one, the proposals for an expanded role in grazings for the Commission were not subject to final board approval before the National Development Plan was published. What were the consequences of this?
The consequences are that there is something in the National Development Plan that the Commission, that the National Development Plan says the Commission will deliver and which the Commission has not agreed to deliver. So there is a continuing tension between ourselves and the Scottish Government about that.
Do you, how long do you anticipate this continuing?
It's difficult to say. So, I mean, the Commission is not against the proposals in the National Development Plan. We can see the value of all of them. It is a question of prioritisation and resources. So if there were a different set of priorities from our side or a bigger envelope of resources, then I think the problem would go away and we would willingly do the things that the government have said they want to, they want us to. I think there is every prospect that there might be a conversation about resources that would take the heat out of it. The other option the government has, of course, is to direct us to do it, which they can do, but they would prefer to do by, you know, they prefer to do by consensus with us. The root of the problem, I know you didn't ask me about the root, Colin, but the root was muddled communication, that there were a number of conversations between the government and the board and myself and SMT colleagues about what was going in the National Development Plan. Drafts were shared, but this was a muddle that never got nailed before the document went to print.
So the actual concern here is not a question of disagreement on a point of fact, but disagreement on prioritising the proposals.
Yes.
Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Just to finish up with one last question, which is, you, I think, Malcolm, you've been fairly clear that you're happy now with the relationship between the sponsorship division and the Crofting Commission.
Correct.
Is there anything you think that still needs to be done to improve that relationship or to make it more effective?
I think there will always be things to improve. But what I feel just now is that as problems or situations arise, I think there's an openness there that we will discuss it straight away. So I don't think I could say it's the perfect relationship and nothing will ever happen. What I do feel is there's an openness that if anything crops up, we won't be in a situation as we are before. We'll be able to have that discussion very clearly at the start.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. You ready? Yeah. Right, can I now move on to the next set of questions, which are weaknesses in business planning, and Richard Leonard has a set of questions there.
Morning, Mr. Matheson. Morning, Mr. Barron. I apologise for being so late, and I'm sorry that I've missed your answers to the earlier questions. There was something which I think was highlighted in the Audit Scotland report, which we did want to look at, which was about business planning and where things stand at the moment. So I just wonder whether, I think there was a medium-term financial plan which was put together. So I just wondered whether you could tell us where that is and what steps you've taken to improve the financial situation of the Commission. Don't know whether Mr. Barron wants to answer that question.
So, yes, finance is actually one of our strong suits in that we have an exceptionally strong finance officer who has got plaudits from auditors, you know, for the way he manages the finances year by year. Forward planning has been the issue that's been raised by Deloitte over the last two or three years. And they've said, can you look ahead and be sure that you're going to be financially sustainable 2, 3, 5 years ahead? That's an interesting one for us because over 75% of our spend is staff and all of our budget comes from the Scottish Government and we get it a year at a time. So you'll appreciate the challenge of, you know, what do you write in the medium-term financial plan when you don't know what your budget's going to be? So when Deloitte said, do a medium-term financial plan, we wrote one which said, this might happen, resources might go down, this might happen, resources might go up. And these are the kind of management responses we'll take in either of those scenarios. So it detailed, these are the kinds of staff we'd have to lose. These are the areas that we'd like to expand if it were possible. Deloitte came back and said, could you do that more thoroughly, looking further ahead, tying it in more definitively with the stated objectives in the corporate plan and so on. So the second version of it last year was better. But they've given us a number of other things to improve again. And we will be doing another one in the near future, tied in with a new corporate plan that we'll be developing at around the time of the election. So it's a work in progress.
Yeah. This is your election to the Commission next year?
Indeed, yes.
Yes, yes. Sorry, I had my heart beating.
Yes, I'm sorry.
And this is a question for both, I think, for both of you, actually, because when I read the report, one of the things that stood out was a failure to properly involve the Commission in the setting of the budget. Was that last year or the year under review in the Audit Scotland report? And I know, Mr. Matheson, I think you were formerly, before you became the convener of the Commission, you were the chair of the Audit and Finance Committee of the Commission.
I was vice chair.
You were vice chair.
The way the
Can I go first? My
question, therefore, is what steps are you taking to avoid a repeat of what was clearly a failing in the communications and relationship between the Commission, the setting of the budget, and the interaction between the Commission and the Scottish Government?
So let me explain that we've always done it that way, and we're going to change it and do it differently. So there isn't a go back when it was right. We've always done it this way. What we have done in the past is that we've involved the board closely in the decisions about priorities, business plans, staffing, and indeed some of the smaller decisions about accommodation, IT, that are going to have implications for the budget. So there's a closeness at that level. What we hadn't done, and what Deloitte had flagged up to us, was actually in those earlier discussions had drafts of the whole budget alongside so they could see, these are the immediate financial implications of those discussions that we're having. Rather, we'd done it by having those discussions, getting our good understanding of their priorities and aims, and then working through the budget as a sort of arithmetical exercise to give light to that. I don't think it will fundamentally change when we bring it forward so that we're actually sharing budget numbers in more detail at an earlier stage in that process, but it will just close that loophole.
I think from the perspective of the Audit and Finance Committee, as an accountant, the calibre of financial control in the Commission is absolutely superb. And each of the Audit and Finance Committees, we have a very detailed analysis of the current financial state of the Commission with the projected outcomes to the end of the year. Now, with the Commission having about 65% of its budget, nearly 70% staff costs, as an AFC, we were always aware of where that would be within the coming year. We were, as an Audit and Finance Committee, comfortable with the information that we were receiving from Bill and the finance team. But as Bill said, that we have followed the recommendations, and I believe the Audit and Finance Committee now are getting involved in an earlier stage. But we were confident about the information that was being conveyed to us at the AFC.
But isn't it odd, and maybe I'm misreading it, but isn't it odd that you have a commission which is largely a majority of which is directly elected, and the Commission doesn't shape the budget of the Crofton Commission? The elected commissioners do not shape the budget of the Crofton Commission, or were excluded. I know, Mr. Barron, you said that was the normal state of affairs, but why would that be? I really don't understand that.
So I disagree that they didn't shape the budget. They did shape the budget. They told us these are the priorities, these are the aims. Sometimes this is what we want you to do with your IT. So it was quite clear that the board were in charge of the direction of the way resources were used. What Deloitte have picked up is, in my view, a technicality about the way those conversations were not numerical early enough, and they're saying they should have been, and we're fine to do that. But I would also point out that our non-staff budget is about £700,000 a year. We're not talking about huge amounts. An awful lot of that is, for all practical purposes, fixed spend on things like accommodation, communications, travel, and so on. It's a question of how much detail do you need to go into at an early stage, and whether you make those things numerical at an early stage.
Okay. Well, let me turn now to workforce planning and staffing and so on. And again, I just wanted to get your views on how you see progress being made to develop the planning of the workforce in the Commission, which, again, I accept is not a huge organisation, but nonetheless, you will have to have a workforce plan. And I wonder how you are reaching conclusions about whether the senior management team mix is correct or whether you need additional resources in that area. Again, Mr. Barron first, and then perhaps Mr. Matheson could comment on that.
So we're on a journey with this one as well. We produced the first of our new style workforce plans at the start of 2020, revamped it at the start of this year, and we'll be doing another one in the near future. The big change that has happened, though, is the Deloitte recommendation that we should get an independent examination of the structure and staffing need of the Commission. And that has been commissioned from external consultants, and the report came in just a couple of weeks ago. The board will be discussing it with them tomorrow. That report and the board's judgments based on it will enable us to take workforce planning to a new level, in that we'll be able to say we've now got some evidence about this is where we ought to be, this is what we need at senior management level, this is what we need at frontline level, and that will mean we have different, more evidenced conversations with the Scottish Government about how to implement that.
The bill, the manpower review was completed about 3 weeks ago by independent consultants. Very, very worthwhile document. And I think for ourselves and the board, it actually has clarified basically the necessary skills and structure of a senior management team. Now, the recommendations have come forward. We as a board will be discussing that at the board meeting tomorrow. And it's a document which I think is giving us a very, very good blueprint as to how the Commission should be structured.
OK. Well, one of the things which I'd picked up was a suggestion that there ought to be a deputy accountable officer to you, Mr. Barron. Is that part of the plan?
It's not, because actually Deloitte are wrong about that, that the Scottish Public Finance Manual doesn't permit me to appoint a deputy accountable officer. It says that what I should do is appoint someone who will be the leader in position if I'm not available, but I'm not entitled to give him accountable officer status, and nor would the permanent secretary do so if I was only going to be away for a short period of time or if I was contactable. So we do have that person in place. We have someone who is designated. I think it's paragraph 7.1 in SPFM. That says how you're supposed to do this, and we have that person in place.
Okay. Well, we will reflect on your evidence and look at the supporting documents that you've referred to.
That'd be helpful. That bit of SPF.
Yeah, I think that would be helpful. I've just got a couple more questions to ask, and one is, and we were told by the Auditor General at the hearing where he gave evidence about the report that there was an improvement plan, I think with a capital I and a capital P. So I wonder whether you could just give us your insight into where you are on that journey on the improvement plan.
So what I call the improvement plan is the same thing as the Deloitte recommendations, the 41 of them. And if you'd been here at the start, convener, you'd have known that we've implemented 33 of them and hoping to get to 35 tomorrow out of the 41. So we're well on track with that. We do have other improvement plans. So there's another one that's recently emerged from the joint training that we've had, which was one of the actions in the first improvement plan. And that, I expect, will be adopted by the board tomorrow as well. So this is an ongoing basis, but we have put an enormous amount of energy into following up those recommendations.
I think also just to point out, whilst we have still six recommendations to complete, they are subsequent two. So we have to complete one recommendation before we move on to some of the others. So the other recommendations will come once we approve the manpower plan tomorrow, then further recommendations will start to be actioned after that.
OK. Well, my final question is one, again, which we reflected on in the session that we had with the Auditor General, which is that I think there was a report by consultants with recommendations in 2016, and it appears that some of the report and the recommendations which come out of the Deloitte audit this time have got an echo of those issues that were raised back then. So I guess the question which is still lingering in my mind, and again, forgive me for missing the first part of the session, but the question that still lingers in my mind is, what confidence should we have as the Public Audit Committee of the Parliament? What confidence should we have that this time it will be different, and that the improvement plan which is in place and some of the fundamental issues that require to be addressed and solved will be this time?
So I would like to draw a very clear distinction between the difficulties in 2016 and the report that's before you now. I listened to the evidence that the Auditor General gave you a few weeks ago, and I'm quoting, he said there were similarities between 2016 and 2020 because there were strong personalities, differences of opinion, and incongruent individual priorities within the board. And that is absolutely true. And actually, I think that's true of every healthy board of an NDPB in Scotland, where you've got this difference of view, and the point is how you bring things together. But the fact that you can describe both of the troubles we're having now and the troubles we were having then with that phrase doesn't mean there's any similarity between them. One of the pieces of evidence for that is the way that the media have reacted, that the media in the Crofton counties were all over the difficulties in 2016. They are not very interested in this one, by comparison. Another one is the staff, that when we were at the depths of the problems in 2016-17, our staff satisfaction rating was 46%. Now, when we measured it last April, at the height of all of this, it's 65%, which is a record high for us. So they are chalk and cheese, and they're not the same. Your question as to how we can be confident about how whether these things will be cemented, I think there's two answers to that. One is that we're documenting a lot more, that the new framework document has gone into areas that had been left vague before about how my dual accountability works. So I think documentation is going to strengthen us. And the other one is continuity on the board. We know, thankfully, that Malcolm and one of his appointed colleagues will continue beyond the election. I'm hoping that some of the elected commissioners will stand and be re-elected. If we can get more continuity rather than these breaks from one board to a completely new set, that will also help.
I think I'd also concur there myself, and one of the other appointed commissioners. We are there for another 3 years. So it's our intention to ensure whoever is on the board is brought up to speed very quickly of what's happened over the last years, and also what we are doing at the present minute to ensure it doesn't happen again. So I think the continuity of having two of us going forward is certainly a benefit, and I think it puts a responsibility in us to ensure that everybody is aware of what has taken place, what we've now put in place, and to ensure it actually is carried through.
I mean, I think my final comment would be that you described, Mr. Barron, this has been not untypical for what happens in other parts of the public sector. I mean, when I read and understand what's happened, there is a high degree of turbulence, and the former convener left, the one before that left under some extraordinary circumstances, which I haven't quite got to the bottom of, but there just seemed to be some turbulence, and of course there was a vote of no confidence or a call for your resignation, Mr. Barron. So, I mean, these are not necessarily recognisable as typical instances of how things have been in other parts of the public sector. So, so the questions that we're asking, and certainly the questions I'm asking, are not because we want you to fail, but because we want you to succeed, because it's extremely important for those Crofton communities and that way of life to be sustained, sustainable and successful. And you've got, it seems to me, you've got a key part to play in that. So I certainly wish you well. I mean, I presume that there is a continuing relationship with Deloitte or the auditors to help you and to work with you through the improvement plan and to make sure that things get onto a track which is sustainable and which will lead to the support that's needed for the Crofton communities.
Yes, there is. Deloitte's working with the Audit and Finance Committee and also feeding back to Bill and his team as well. And again, you know, from a board perspective, we have a lot of confidence in our auditors. And as such, their, if you like, their help, their experience is invaluable to us.
Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. And if I can now ask Willie Coffey, he's got a set of questions.
Thanks very much, convener. Good morning to you both. I was listening carefully to Colin Beattie's line of question and Malcolm and Bill, and he was talking about the, where these problems arose from. And in your opening remarks, Malcolm, you said that much of it, I think, was arising from unusual legislation.
Yes.
Could I just go back there for a moment and allow, just for the purposes of the record, to allow you to elaborate on that and make it clear to the committee and everyone whether you're saying that the problems that arose in the Crofton Commission arose from dysfunctional legislation or whether they were from management failures or a bit of both?
I think what I was explaining to start with is that board members assumed incorrectly that the chief executive reported to and was accountable to the board. I think the one of the major issues that arose is that when sponsor via the government were asking Bill to help them out in other situations, you know, I think our view as a board was, well, hold on a minute, that's our responsibility, because we didn't appreciate at the time that Bill, being a secondee from the Scottish Government, his, if you like, reporting structure was to the government via sponsor division. So I think that being clarified meant that we were a lot clearer on the roles, responsibilities and who reported where, etc. And I think, as we said earlier, the change in the framework document, and I think one of the biggest changes in that document is it's very, very clear. The chief executive reports to and is accountable to the board. So that confusion is gone. And I think the boards, and again, I think Bill touched on it earlier, the board are all individuals from a very commercial background. So therefore, they expect it would be operating in a very commercial manner, i.e. your chief executive reports. And I think that's where a lot of the problems stem from. That has been resolved now.
In making that journey, why wouldn't you have arrived at that position, firstly, about concerns about framework and governance and so on, rather than jumping to things like votes of no confidence in the chief executive? Why? It seems to me that that's the wrong way around.
I think
did you raise those concerns with the government, and did you say to the government, your legislation isn't fit for purpose here, and why not?
Right, I think because the situation never arose, I think that's the answer to it. The relationships, the way it was working, there never came a situation where something happened that the board would have taken a divergent view. That just didn't happen. So therefore, you know, that understanding didn't really exist, I would suggest, for about the first 4 years of the board. It was only when a decision was made, and again, as Bill's explained, due to very, very difficult circumstances, that the board were therefore surprised that, you know, that relationship wasn't as we anticipated. I think it's purely a no situation had arisen before that called it into question.
And the position now, though, has the Commission said to the government, this legislation is perhaps not fit for purpose?
Absolutely. The framework document has now been agreed between management, the convener, and sponsor. And as well as the framework document, I think the board are a lot clearer now on the roles and responsibilities, not necessarily from a legal or documented perspective, but from an operational perspective as well.
So I've got a slightly different take on this. So there are two odd things about our constitution. One is that I am not just on civil service terms and conditions, I'm actually appointed by the Scottish Government. So they choose who is going to be the chief executive of the Crofton Commission. And that does create a slightly funny dynamic right from the off. And I think what Malcolm's been explaining is that we've learnt how to live with that legislation, that we've recognised that although that is an unusual route by which I got my job is to be entirely accountable to the board in exactly the same way as any other chief executive would be. And that means that in future, if they want to change me, then I should respect that, because that's where the accountability ought to be, as it were. The other unusual thing about our constitution is the fact that six members of the commission change on one day every 5 years. And that has also brought raised eyebrows about how do you get continuity? How do you get, how do you avoid the problem where not too many people don't understand the role at the same time? So that's another one which Scottish Government are thinking about. It may not be easy to change that.
OK, great. Thank you for that part. I would just like to finish off, if I may, just to follow up on a couple of questions that Richard Leonard led there about the improvement plan and looking to the future. And there's been several mentions, Malcolm and Bill, about the recommendations, and 33 out of 41 have been achieved. Who agrees with that?
Sorry?
Who agrees that those have been achieved?
The board.
The board.
The board signed off on the last board meeting. Mm. We at that stage, I think we had 31, was it 29 or 31? So the board at that stage reviewed the report, we reviewed the recommendations. Within, internally, it's not just a case of, well, tick. What we have beside it is what has happened over the last 6 months, all the actions have been taken. Prior to the board meeting, that went out to the board. The board reviewed it, had the chance to question Bill and his management team on these actions, and the board then actually could turn around and say, yes, they will, however, be audited by Deloitte. So whilst we as a board are saying, yes, we accept that, we can see it's happening, ultimately it will be Deloitte's when they come round to doing the annual audit, which will review that and actually confirm it. Mm.
And what about the community, the Crofton community themselves, are they seeing the benefit of the achievement of these recommendations? Is it too early to tell? Is it mostly structural, internal changes and recommendations that have taken place? When will people see the benefits of the achievement of what's in the improvement plan?
So I hope that the Croftons in the Crofton communities are not too directly affected by this. Indirectly, they will be, of course, because it affects the whole operation from distracted management, as it were. I think there is a lot of support from the Crofton communities. They are behind the Commission. They want the Commission to succeed, and they want us to get round these difficulties. But I don't think they are feeling directly affected by them.
I would concur with that. The feedback the commissioners are receiving from Crofton communities is that there are probably two or three incredibly important items for them, and these important items are not included, are not part of it. I think they see this as an internal document, and it's to their benefit that the internal, if you like, structure and internal operations of the commission are improved. But it doesn't affect their day-to-day involvement with the Commission.
And the remaining recommendations that you're continuing to work on, are they the most difficult, challenging?
Not particularly. I mean, for example, there's one of them which is the longer-term financial planning. You know, we have to get a manpower report. We have to decide the management structure and then cost that before you can then carry on and do another 3 or 4 years financial planning. So the ones, the majority that are left are actually subsequent to ones we've completed. They follow on.
Okay, and the final point, you mentioned Deloitte there. They will conduct a follow-up audit to check on whether they agree that the recommendations that you've completed are satisfactory.
As far as I'm aware, as part of their annual audit, they will review the document, which I would expect them to do.
Okay, right. Thank you both. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Wally. Does anybody else want to come in with any final questions? No. In that case, we've got to the end of our questions for today. So thank you very much, Malcolm and Bill, for all your evidence. We will reflect on all the answers that you've given us. And we look forward to getting the written reports on how you intend to take forward the recommendations of the staffing review, whether the framework was agreed, and also the further recommendations implemented after your meeting tomorrow. Okay, thanks very much.
The opportunity to explain the progress we've made. Thank you.
Thank you. So we will now suspend the meeting to allow for a changeover of witnesses.
Can I resume this morning's meeting of the Public Audit Committee and introduce agenda item 3, which is a session where we're going to review the Audit Scotland report into NHS NSS services and the PPE report in particular. And I want to, first of all, welcome the witnesses who all join us online this morning. I'd like to welcome Mary Morgan, who's the Chief Executive of NSS, Carolyn Lowe, the Director of Finance, and Gordon Beattie, who's the Director of National Procurement. I'd also like to welcome Caroline Lamb, who's the Chief Executive for NHS Scotland. And I think accompanying Caroline this morning is Richard McCallum, who's the Director of Health, Finance and Governance in the Scottish Government. As you are all virtual this morning, could I suggest that if you want to come in at any point, if you put an R in the chat box function, and also please note that you don't have to press your own mute and unmute button. The broadcasting unit will do that for you. And can I say that our time is necessarily limited, and I know that Mary and Caroline are going to give lead-off statements. And might I suggest to both Caroline and Mary, if you want to bring people in particular to bolster or substantiate or develop any of the answers that you want to give, then you could do that and encourage that person to come in straight after you. So without further ado, could I invite Mary Morgan to give us a short opening statement? Mary.
Yes, thank you, convener, and to the wider Public Audit Committee for welcoming me and my colleagues to the meeting today. We're very pleased to have the opportunity to discuss the reports that you've previously mentioned, and I would like to extend my thanks to Audit Scotland for their reports and their acknowledgement of the integral role that our organisation has played in response to the pandemic in Scotland. Though the past 2 years have undoubtedly been the most challenging in the history of NSS, our teams continue to deliver solutions at an unprecedented rate to ensure the health, safety and well-being of the people of Scotland. During the pandemic, we protected frontline workers by sourcing and supplying more than 1 billion items of PPE to health and social care, and established a virtual portal to help process inquiries during periods of significant pressure. We've also established a domestic supply chain for PPE, with 88% of supplies coming from Scottish companies, which not only provides Scotland with more resilience, but also an added economic benefit. We've played a vital role in COVID testing by establishing 94 testing centres across the country, along with 3 dedicated regional hub laboratories as part of the NHS in Scotland, along with all of the associated procurement, legal and digital services that this has required. We swiftly established the National Contact Centre to deliver the contact tracing programme, recruiting and training more than 1,200 contact tracers of our own and supporting an additional 2,000 across partner organisations. Our digital and security team has delivered exceptionally, initially by rolling out Microsoft Teams across the NHS in Scotland, revolutionising our work environment and ensuring thousands of NHS staff could continue to work safely from home. They provided security assurance and management expertise for the Protect Scotland app, as well as developing and rolling out both the Check-in Scotland app and the COVID vaccine appointment scheduling system. National Services Scotland has supported the build, stocking and decommissioning of the NHS Louisa Jordan Field Hospital. We've provided legal guidance across numerous aspects of the pandemic response and continue to play a key role in the COVID vaccination programme. While there have been exceptional achievements for our organisation, we acknowledge the points raised in the reports about variation to standard processes and aspects of transparency when it came to procurement and the awarding of contracts during this time of extreme pressure. We take on board the recommendations, particularly regarding consistency of recording and publishing documentation. And to address this, I can let you know that we've fully reinstated the standard processes for regulated procurement, contract approval and notice publication. Once again, I would like to thank the committee for having us here today, and we welcome the questions that you will have. Thank you.
Thanks, Mary. Could I invite Caroline Lamb to make a short opening statement? Caroline.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, convener. I welcome Audit Scotland's reports and the opportunity to give evidence to the committee today. The last 22 months have been exceptional in terms of the demands placed on our health and care services, and in turn, the response of NHS and social care staff has been nothing short of extraordinary. I'd like to place on record my thanks to NSS for, as the Auditor General puts it, the pivotal role that they played and continue to play in that extraordinary response. As reports set out, we responded at pace to an immediate threat, and one that has evolved and continues to evolve over time. This has presented significant challenges, and in response to that, we've seen amazing innovation and progress. PPE supplies were not only sustained during a period of unprecedented global demand, but a resilient supply chain was established, including domestic PPE manufacturers. We've seen the establishment and continued operation of our National Test and Protect programme, the opening of an entirely new hospital in just 20 days, and quickly repurposed to provide outpatient capacity and vaccinations, and of course the delivery of vaccines to millions of people in a matter of months. These achievements are remarkable, but as the report sets out, there are lessons to be learned to ensure that we're best placed to respond to the ongoing and future challenges. I'm committed to doing just that, to embedding the innovation that we've seen as we continue to remobilise our NHS and continue to respond to COVID and the new variants that we see emerging. And I'll be very happy to answer any of the committee's questions.
Thanks very much indeed to both of you. I've got a quite particular question and then a more open question to begin with before I ask other members of the committee to ask the questions that they've got. So my first more particular one is just on that issue around PPE supply chains. We've looked at awe at the growth from 0 to 88% in the percentage of domestic supply of PPE, and I think that's, you know, it's been one of the more interesting consequences of the pandemic that we've been living through. I wonder whether, and I think this is probably more for Mary Morgan, I don't know whether you can tell us what the balance of trade is now. Is there, are we still importing some PPE, and if so, where from? But also, we're also interested as a committee, Mary, in whether, given the growth of the PPE supply chain in Scotland, whether it's in a position to perhaps supply into international markets, including the lesser developed parts of the world that perhaps need PPE at a time when we appear to have at least as much as we need, or possibly even looking at a surplus. So, Mary, do you want to respond to that?
Yes, thank you. And I'll turn to Gordon Beattie just in a moment or two, who'll be able to give you some more detail in and around that. Excuse me. The success of that has been largely down to, I think, two pieces of work. One is collaboration, particularly with Scottish Enterprise, in helping to secure Scottish markets. And also, in my statement, I referred, and the auditor report refers to the opening of a portal where many people stepped forward with their capabilities in developing not only PPE, but testing capacity also. And that portal was critical in helping the procurement teams to assess really the potential that Scotland had across its manufacturers. So working together with Scottish Enterprise, we were able to harness the Scottish capability. If I turn to Gordon Beattie, Gordon can give you a more detailed answer about the potential for international market.
Hey, good morning, everybody. We've been working closely through the Supply Chain Development Programme with colleagues in Scottish Government and Scottish Enterprise and our suppliers who have stood up magnificently to the emergency that came before us, and we will continue to look at our forward forecasts We'll continue to seek best value and high quality products, and we really want to support our Scottish businesses in that endeavour. The Scottish businesses are looking to use this as a springboard for exports, and some cases have been successful already. We've had some good news recently from one of the suppliers of specialist masks who developed a transparent mask, and that is now being used within Scotland and has been deployed across our health boards, as being final assessment being done in East England. And they've also, as I understand it, won export orders into Europe. So that's a great example of the initiative here being a springboard for exports. We obviously don't have a direct role in that in terms of successes of those suppliers, but we are helping as best we can to enable that success.
Thanks, Mr. Beattie. That's helpful. The other question which I had, which as I said is a bit more general, but again is directed to NSS. Really is to reflect on one of the conclusions in the report, which I think was on paragraph 13, where the conclusion was drawn that NSS is now heavily reliant on non-recurring funding to deliver services, and we're a week out from the Scottish Government tabling its budget before Parliament. The Auditor General had cautioned that reliance on non-recurring funding, and I think the quotation was, limits the ability of NSS to effectively plan and resource future developments. So I just wonder whether, Mary, you could start by telling us whether that funding uncertainty is real, and are there areas of your work that you've been forced to deprioritise because of that, and what are the risks entailed in doing that, if that is indeed what you've been required to do?
Thank you, Convener. The first thing that I would say is that the nature of our services is very often non-recurrent in nature. And clearly, as we've gone through the past couple of years of the pandemic, it's not clear what the longevity of the pandemic response and what business as usual in that regard might look like. So a lot of our funding and financing related to the COVID response is by its nature recurring, and we are actively planning with what that future might be, but clearly it's difficult at this time to make assumptions in and around that. We do recognise that we need to transform, and there have been opportunities presented through COVID around new ways of working to do so, optimising a digital-first approach where possible, and realising the benefits of reducing travel going forward. We have not had to pause or delay or stop any of our services because of funding difficulties or funding constraints. That has more been about just the mobilisation required through COVID and the prioritisation of that. But perhaps I can ask Carolyn Lowe, who's our Director of Finance, to give you a little bit more detail around what we're doing in that space.
Thank you, Mae. It's true to say that if we go back to 2015-16, our baseline funding was £317 million, and that represented 80% of our total funds. In 2021, our baseline had increased to £337 million, but it was only 43% of our overall funding. As an organisation, our gross expenditure is £1.3 billion, a significant amount of what we do. We pass through and are paid for services from health boards. So as an organisation, we have a large reach, but we're underpinned by a relatively small proportion of that through baseline funding. We need to transform as an organisation, and we have a sustainability programme underway, and our services are all planning for the future to see what can we do differently, how do we embrace hybrid working so that we can be both financial and environmentally sustainable. But importantly, in a digital-first environment, how do we deliver our services differently? And we're really confident that the underlying deficit that Audit Scotland identified in the report, that's around 13 million. We can recover that by doing things differently. But we look forward to be able to have, to continue the really strong working relationship and partnership that we have with Scottish Government Finance to explore the aspects of our services which have been funded non-recurrently for a long period of time, and to convert some of that to baseline. And these conversations are currently ongoing. And obviously, Mary mentioned too our COVID services and the COVID response and the extent to which we will have to maintain those services on a long-term basis. It's important for us to be able to confirm that position so that we can provide certainty to the staff that we have employed to deliver the excellent services that they are currently delivering, and to provide them with continued certainty of employment. But I can reassure the convener that actually these discussions are ongoing with government, and we're confident that we'll get to an agreed position very soon. We have funding confirmed to September of next year, and that gives us enough space to plan what that future looks like.
Thanks very much indeed. And if time permits, we will come back, I think, to revisit some of those questions around the funding of NSS. But I want to turn now to Craig Hoy, who's got some questions to put to you. Craig.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I just want to drill down a little bit into the longer-term approach to PPE supply and demand, and look specifically at how you're working with partners to develop the capacity for both the ongoing normal needs and perhaps for another pandemic should something like that occur. But just to capture really where we've got to, perhaps this is one for Mary. How has NHS, NSS, learned from the process that you've just been through? Not so much specifically what you've learned, but what processes have you gone through to capture the learning? And how are you making sure that what you've learned is baked into future planning?
Yeah, we have already got two additional new warehouses to increase our stock and increase our supplies, and also are actively looking at what stock we retain on a business as usual basis. So not necessarily increasing all of our stock lines, depends on what their turnover is. There does need to be turnover in play. So a lot of the data that we've used around inventory management and inventory control has been critical to supporting those pieces. Perhaps Gordon can tell you more specifically about the detailed work of the team in gathering data and working together with Scottish Government colleagues to identify individual lines that may be needed going forward. Gordon, I don't know if you want to come in.
Yes, that I will do, Mary. We've spent a lot of work on our forward planning arrangement. So it's one of the reflections we've had and lessons learned from our experiences to improve the way in which we understand what the future pandemic may look like, and to have good forward planning arrangements and demand profiles of our key products that we require. So that's underway, but really a close relationship with Scottish Government and Public Health Scotland and others who are involved in that kind of forward planning. And we have in place good models that allow us to predict what we will need. And that's allowing us to get well ahead of the game in terms of forward buying. And we have, as Mary said, established two new large warehouses in Scotland. And we have very good stock of the key products we think we will need in the future. What we're also doing is working across the public sector to understand what the needs will be on a wider footing, and to work with colleagues in the public sector and the Scottish Government in terms of future pandemic readiness. And that includes the role in which we would play of providing a national stockpile and access to that national stockpile. So that work is all underway. And one last bit I'd add in terms of data, as Mary mentioned there, is we've got really good data in NHS Scotland. It's one of the things, we have a great single finance system, a great single procurement system. But one of the areas where we had a need to improve was the visibility of stocks at a local hospital level. And over the last year, we've implemented the purchase of a new system that provides with inventory management at an individual hospital ward level. That's been rolled out at the moment, and that'll give us a great deal of extra visibility and to understand where we have to supply a product to make sure that everybody has the products that are essential for their needs. So that's the key elements of work which are ongoing at the moment.
Thank you. And how do you go through that process of balancing the need for the stockpile and the cost of the stockpile and the fact that I'm assuming that those products are perishable? Are you moving more towards a sort of just-in-time ordering system, or is the stockpile important, just bearing in mind that the absence of a stockpile was something that was criticised at the beginning of the pandemic?
Yeah, it's certainly a balance to be struck. What we found in the beginning was that the stockpile was designed to have an eight-week period to allow us to replenish. And clearly, with the collapse of the international supply chains, as referenced in the report, that became a real issue for us to try and ensure we had supplies coming in time to replace that stock. So we've increased our stock levels, and we have good stock levels at the moment. And we're well ahead of that. What we have to do is to make sure we have where stocks have got a shelf life, is we able to turn those stocks over. And that's one of the discussions we're having about the role across the public sector in Scotland of a national stockpile, so more areas can access it, and therefore we have more of a stock turn that allows to maintain stock and shelf life. But clearly, you know, pandemic is hopefully a fairly rare occurrence, and there will be times where we will have stocks that we'll need to try and use before they run out of date. So that's just something we are working with and thinking through as we look to the future.
And I think
Caroline Lamb and Mary Morgan wants to come back on that, but Caroline Lamb first.
Thank you very much. I was just going to add to that. Obviously, Scottish Government has a key role to play here as well. So we've been working with NSS and with other partners across the public sector to learn the lessons from the pandemic so far and to take those into future PPE procurement. So that includes absolutely looking at the work that Gordon just described to you around understanding of the data and being able to be clear about what we need to stockpile and how we predict demand and supply. But also thinking about the further development of Scottish manufacturing capability around thinking about innovation and opportunities for further innovation, being clear about a policy for PPE provision to primary and social care providers, and very much focusing on those lessons learned. So this is all wrapped up in the PPE Futures Programme with a view to developing a strategy which we hope will be produced by the end of this financial year. Thanks.
That's married. Mary's coming.
Sorry, I was going to come in, sorry.
Yeah.
So we've spoken a little bit about the importance of data, and one of the pieces you've asked about is how have we learned some of the lessons, and I have to say that some of that has been about a dynamic process. So, and how we've applied the learning early on from PPE across other areas. So we've worked very closely with Public Health Scotland and our digital services to produce more real-time dashboards and access to data at the point of need so that people can access their own data and have that wider communication. One of the things that we learned very early on is about that communication and shared intelligence about what is happening, and the PPE team, National Procurement, with their colleagues, developed a daily stock bulletin, a daily bulletin that went out across NHS Scotland and our partners. We learned from that experience and replicated it, for example, in testing and beyond, and more laterally with the vaccination programme, for example, we're using Teams channels to improve those communications. So a lot of the lessons that we've learned, yes, are around the PPE provision, around stockpiling, and we need to consider those going forward because we remain in that pandemic response piece. But a lot of the learnings have been dynamic and have been replicated and tested and quite innovative in the way that we have moved forward. So we do need to have a bit of time for evaluation and what it might look like when we have when we're post-pandemic.
Good. Obviously, there's one of the phrases that's come up is partnership, working in partnership, and the capacity building that's taking place within the domestic PPE industry. Is that sustainable, and does that pivot towards buying domestic product? Are we seeing that being replicated by health services internationally? There's perhaps one for Mary again.
Partnership working is definitely sustainable, and I believe is very enabled by our new ways of working. So we found that using Teams approaches, using some of the mechanisms we've pulled in place, it's much easier to have wider communications with people and to work together with them. I'm not sure about the sustainable on an international basis. The work around future procurement strategies, we have a procurement strategy. We also need to consider the carbon footprint of our purchasing, and part of that strategy is to buy locally wherever possible. But we will continue to work with our partners to make sure that we are sourcing locally to Scotland wherever we possibly can. And that's embedded within the procurement strategies that are published.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks very much indeed. I want now to invite Colin Beattie to ask some questions.
Colin. Thank you, Convener. It's already been touched on the very credible situation where there was no PPE made in Scotland prior to the pandemic, but now 88% of all PPE, excluding gloves, I believe, are manufactured here. What kind of support was given to Scottish companies? Was there financial support given? Were there specific? Were the skills here already to develop this? How did this come about? Probably, I don't know. I'll pick somebody at random. Mary.
Well, again, I'm going to defer to Gordon, who has all of that detail to hand. There were many assessments that needed to be undertaken. We have some of the data and figures of the number of people who came forward offering their services, number of companies that offered their services, and there were a considerable number of those that went through an assessment process. And we worked jointly with Scottish Enterprise to carry out quality assurance and assurance processes with them, and clearly finance and cost was part of the award of those contracts. But Gordon can let you know some more detail about what actually was gone through by way of process.
Thanks, Mary. I did lose a wee bit of reception there just in the question, Mr. Beattie, so I hope I'll pick this up correctly. So what we looked at in terms of our supply chain that was in place, we worked closely with our contracted suppliers and known suppliers. And really what we're trying to get there was access to stock that was available. So that was the first phase of it, encouraging, trying to locate that stock and buying that stock and bring that in. It became quite apparent that the stock wasn't available once that initial range of purchases had taken place, because of the world market where everyone was chasing the same stock. So what we had to do next was trying to secure production. And that production we secured. Some of that production we secured overseas, and some of that production became apparent to secure in Scotland. I mean, we went to suppliers who were known to us, and one example supplier who was an existing provider of masks to the NHS Scotland, and particularly the specialist mask, FFP3 respirator masks, which had already been fit tested for use by a lot of our staff, and were a preferred product to be used. So that gave us a point of reference and a point of discussion for that supplier. And it became apparent that the supplier couldn't access the overseas supply chains, but they could look to onshore that capacity into Scotland. And that was the kind of initiating element of talking to these particular suppliers and building that capacity in Scotland. At the same, we've seen for a number of the different PPE examples that we have, and that eventually, as we said, led us to have a really good response from our Scottish businesses And the ability, is that, as I mentioned already, deliver 88% of our PPE from Scottish sources. With the exception of Bob. So that's the process. All of the suppliers, clearly, we do full checks on in terms of their standards, in terms of their factory standards, ethical and fair wage use, etc. So all of that is done. And companies we were using from overseas initially, we work closely with Scottish Enterprise colleagues to undertake those checks as well. So we had a good level of due diligence on the suppliers that we chose.
Gordon, were there any, say, specialised areas of PPE that we can't produce here in Scotland? Is that the reason why we're not at 100%? I'm being ambitious here.
Yeah, the main ones gloves, really. Gloves are typically produced in the Far East, and with very little capacity, with very little capacity in Europe, never mind within the UK. But we have some shoots of a new production in the UK, and we're engaged with companies who are trying to set up a business in the UK. So there's some options there emerging, Mr. Beattie, but at the moment we have the predominant of the PPEs come from Scottish sources.
Now, clearly at the moment we're some way from being able to say that the pandemic is over. How resilient is our supply chain in terms of PPE? As far as we can project, is it reasonably secure?
Yes, we've established good relationships through one of our master vendor contract providers, and they have they are able to pull a supply chain that includes the Scottish-based organisation. So we continue to have a very close relationship with that master vendor and indeed their supply chain to ensure that we have that capacity in place. At the moment, we've secured good stocks of PPE, and that's giving us a long-term projection, certainly over this next year. But what we're doing now is keeping our eye very closely on what's emerging at the moment, working very closely with our colleagues in terms of that future pandemic modelling, and ensuring that we have the future supply orders in place and that production capacity secured. And that will also include discussions through that master vendor and down to our production Scotland.
Given the changes that are happening with the virus that we're dealing with and so on, do we have confidence that the type of PPE we're producing, the type of PPE we might need in the future, are we reasonably satisfied that we can secure those? And I know it's a little bit of a hypothetical question for the future, but do we have that flexibility to be able to affect the changes in PPE that might be needed?
I think the answer to that is yes. We're having close discussions with our supply chain partners. We know we can ramp up capacity, and we can ramp up capacity in Scotland, for example, as well. So those are the discussions that are going on just now. And we clearly are keeping very close discussions with our infection prevention control colleagues in terms of any change to guidance that may occur, and we can react to that. The discussions we're having on the supply chain to try and maintain that flexibility and the ability to ramp up if required.
The convener, in his opening questions, talked about export markets. Are we aware to what extent export markets are, I won't say important, but maybe significant in maintaining the viability of the local supply chain? In other words, the production line, is it geared just to Scotland and a wee bit of export, or does it rely for its viability on a proportion of exports? Gordon, I'm going to pick you again.
I can answer that. Yes, no, that's fine. I think the answer to that really is it's not just the NHS or health that these items can be used for. So the companies, I guess, will have a broader marketplace to service, and they know their business obviously much better than I do, and we'll continue to help and support them in developing products, and hopefully that will allow them to have the advantage of exporting to worldwide markets. But I think it is down for the individual companies in support of our, obviously, Scottish enterprise ourselves to ensure that they can access those markets and be successful. And I know they're doing that. They're trying to modernise and improve the efficiency of their equipment, etc., to make a good value proposition.
And just a last angle on this. Obviously, one of the important byproducts of this, apart from the PPE itself, is the fact that it's created jobs here in Scotland. Now, do we know what proportion of these jobs are permanent? And do we know if that's likely to continue?
I can't tell you what proportion are permanent, but I do know there's about 470 jobs that were created. A major chunk of those were created in Dumfries and Galloway, and that company is investing heavily in that production and that workforce. And I guess that is to look towards their future business, exports, etc. So that's a great example of this kind of springboard that we'll be able to create from the NHS Scotland business and indeed other parts of the United Kingdom in terms of purchase, and then that springboard into exports. So it's a good example we've seen there in that particular company.
And just a final question, which you may or may not be able to answer. Obviously, the companies producing PPE have geared up their production lines in order to produce the quantities of PPE and the types of PPE that are required. That probably won't continue at this pace forever, at least we hope not. At some point it'll hopefully settle back to what might become a normal level. Do we know if these companies, and I'm thinking of the resilience here, will they be able to repurpose their production lines into other areas at the end of this? Or is it a case of, well, we're going to have to lay the surplus people off and reduce production?
I hope so. As I said, some of the products are not just used in health; they're used in industry and other specialists, chemical industry and laboratories, etc. So I do hope they can do that. The good example I mentioned earlier on, the transparent masks, so that is already a repurposing of one of the production mechanisms in the business in Greece and Galloway to repurpose that equipment to make this specialist mask, which allows the user to see the mouth and help where people require to see somebody else speaking. So that's a great example of already repurposing equipment.
Thank you, Mira.
Thanks very much indeed. I'm going to now invite Sharon Dowie to ask a couple of questions, and after Sharon I will ask Willie Coffey. But Sharon, first of all.
Hello, everybody. Just a question on the environmental impact of PPE. The Auditor General's briefing paper recommended that when developing a future approach to PPE supply and demand, the Scottish Government and NHS NSS should consider how to support suppliers to develop more environmentally sustainable PPE. So I think we've probably all seen masks lying in the street and in bushes and in fields. So what is the current environmental impact of PPE, and also what work is being undertaken by the Scottish Government, NHS, NSS and partners to develop more environmentally sustainable PPE, and what are the challenges associated with it? Don't know who wants to answer that one. Is Gordon there?
Gordon. Volunteering again.
Gordon.
Okay, yeah. I'll try and answer in two parts. In terms of the sustainable future, we have initiated an innovation competition through colleagues in NHS Tayside. That competition's on the go just now, and that's inviting companies with innovative ideas and solutions with regarding to sustainable and reusable PPE. So that's ongoing. That'll carry on over the next few months. We expect to see the results of that competition through our innovation approach over the early part of spring. So that's what we've already introduced some items such as launderable gowns. We brought those in quite early on in the pandemic, and that takes a bit of the pressure off the kind of full kind of non-sterile gowns that you have to wear if you're doing aerosol generated procedures. So that's in place already, and they can be used up to 50 times and can be laundered through our NHS laundries. So they are there at the moment. But the environmental impact is that we have seen you can imagine an increase in tonnage of clinical waste. Typically in a hospital, that's gone up by about 20%. And the community community services we didn't previously use DTE to a great extent, that's gone up a much higher percentage. We see the tonnage going up, but also what we see is the volume going up. You can imagine these things are quite light, and they add quite a lot to bulk. In some respects, it helps the waste processing. Obviously, all of our clinical waste goes through our clinical waste processes, and that reduces the density of waste, which makes it easier to go through machines and shredders and processes for treatment. But it has increased the volume. So you imagine we have these big 700-litre sort of wheelie bin things that we use in the hospitals. They would take about 75 kilos, and they're probably taking about 45 kilos now. So that increases the kind of movements to deal with that waste. So there are a couple of things which are directly impacting on that. And we're working closely to understand how we can reduce that and improve that in the future.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else coming in on that? No?
Does anybody else want to come in on that, the question of the environmental impact of the types of PPE that have been manufactured and used? If not...
No. Okay, we'll see the results in the spring.
So I'm going to invite Willie Coffey to ask a couple of questions now. So, Willie, over to you.
Right, thanks, Richard, and good morning to everyone in the panel. It's probably too early to gaze ahead, isn't it, beyond the pandemic, given where we are. But could I just invite perhaps Mary and Caroline to say a few words about the remobilisation plan that you've been asked to work on? Mary, you gave us some great examples in your opening remarks about some of the achievements that we've managed to see, and you particularly mentioned the digital aspect and using Teams and so on and so forth. So could you say, as part of the remobilisation plan and the getting back to business as usual, whether we'll retain some of those good elements of practice that were forced upon us but have turned out to be very advantageous for the way that we all work and the staff are having to work? So could you give us a little flavour of how you see that going ahead and whether we'll retain the best of what we've seen that came out as a result of COVID?
Yes, absolutely. We've undertaken a programme called Future Ready, and which has seen a tremendous engagement from across our staff internally. In fact, yesterday I had a Future Ready question and answer session. We had more than 900 of our staff participate in that process. So the positive aspects of staff engagement that we've experienced around working virtually and working digitally has been really positive. What our staff have told us is that around 90% of them would prefer to continue to work from home into the future. Some of them not wholly working from home, but in a hybrid type scenario. And we really are working towards making that happen and making it so for them. We have all the processes in place. We rolled out all of the equipment that they would need from that. There are some things that we need to iron out, and that dynamic process of risk assessment and learning is ongoing. But really, we do see ourselves embracing that. Clearly, within NSS, we have a number of services that are inseparable from the people who deliver them. So, for example, our warehousing staff and logistics staff need to be in the warehouse in order to be able to make the distribution happen. We have a substantial amount of frontline staff in the Scottish National Blood Transfusion Service who have had to change their ways of working. What we're seeking to do is harness the best of their learnings to make sure that their work environment has improved. For example, the Blood Transfusion Service has been able to bring in, has out of necessity brought in an appointment system. And that has had some real benefits for donors who know when they are going to be going through the process of blood donation. But it also means that we can match our appointings, the appointing of people with specific blood groups, to the demand that we're seeing for blood groups across the sector. So we're very keen to embrace the changes that we've experienced and to continue to work for them because it has been so positive. I think the other thing is that is perhaps unseen. I was speaking to a member of staff. We've needed to learn how to lead in different ways. Now, many multinational companies will already have had leadership from a distance, but that's new to us in the NHS and in our working environment. And I'm really amazed and in awe about how staff have felt empowered and have felt able to step forward and bring forward their new ideas. I was speaking to a member of staff the other day, and we're going to hear more about her story. When she joined us just about a year ago, she identified the need for managers to be able to get together and to have a community of practice. So she developed a Teams channel that's called the Management Hub. It offers opportunity for training, for shared experiences. And we have a water cooler place that opens up in the morning that people can drop into and just have those informal conversations that we may have been missing. So we're testing and trying out new ways of working that actually support our staff in delivering their services in different ways. But one of the things that I would really labour is that we've been able to be much more accessible to our staff. There is no way we would have been able to have 900 people in one room for an hour in a question and answer session, and to begin to see them having the dialogue and actually answering their own questions as a community has been phenomenal.
That's pretty amazing, actually. The technology worked, did it, with 900 people online at the same time, yeah. Did it? I mean, it's a great point you make about inevitably, because of the situation we were in, we had to pretty rapidly develop new skills and expertise as a consequence of the situation we found ourselves. So do you very much see that it's not going to be a one-off and we'll go back to normal? You're going to retain, enhance, embrace all those skills and expertise as best you can. And I would imagine that it will inevitably lead you to changing the way you want to work and the staff want to work in the future, and to hopefully embed those practices and that skills and experience as you go forward.
Yes, I completely agree, and that's what Future Ready is all about. It is about taking a digital first approach to the way that we deliver our services and really empowering staff to make their decisions. Work is not necessarily or not always where you do it or when you do it. It's what you do and what you produce. So we're well rehearsed on that, and we have teams who are willing to take that forward. I think it's not just something that we would like to do. It's something that we need to do. We made reference, and Caroline Lowe made reference to the fact we need to transform and change because there are financial benefits to this way of working. We no longer have people travelling up and down the M8 corridor between Glasgow and Edinburgh to attend a meeting. So we are more productive in our time, and we still have all of the benefits of delivering services in a new way. And it's also allowed us to collaborate much, much more freely. So the fact that we can all jump on and off a Teams meeting and still get work done is really, really positive. So it's not just a wish, and it's not just from an experience point of view. It's something that we need to do for both our financial sustainability and indeed for climate sustainability going forward.
I recognise that, convener, that I'm one of those who also doesn't need to run up the M77 and the M8 every day to come to Parliament. It's a huge advantage for me. Just finally to ask, invite Caroline for us.
Caroline,
yes. Well, yeah. Thank you, Caroline.
So thank you very much. And I'll maybe just expand a little bit on what Mary said, but apply that across the context of the broader NHS and social care system. So I think the use of digital technologies and having really timely access to data are some of the key things that we've learned during this pandemic and that we've really, really benefited from. So having that daily access to data around what's happening with the pandemic has been critical to informing our decision making and the public messaging. And I think, you know, as we start to think about what implications that has for us going forward, members will be aware of just the really significant pressures that the NHS and our social care systems are experiencing at the moment. We announced a £300 million package of investment in October. And key to understanding the impact of that investment is having that daily data in relation to just managing the system. So it's management information around where we are, around which of the bits of the system, because this is a complete system and we focus on A&E weights and they are really important, but actually they're a barometer in relation to how the rest of the system is working. So I think increasingly we are becoming very heavily dependent on and using data in a really good way that helps us to understand what we need to do to make improvements to the system. So in the short term, that's working. In the longer term as well, and I'm thinking about our NHS recovery plan that was launched in August, we're absolutely looking at some of the digital innovations. So if you take things like Near Me, the video consulting system that was available, it was tried and tested pre-pandemic, but it wasn't really being used. And now it's been rolled out and has been enormously successful, not just in enabling people to engage with their GPs and enabling people to see their consultants, but also being used in care homes and enabling people in care homes to get medical consultations at a point when it was difficult for people to move around and also to keep engaged with their families. So there's lots and lots of things that we can start to deploy digital technology and innovation to support that recovery. I mean, telecare is actually probably one of the most common care supports across Scotland. And as that gets transitioned to digital technology, it provides us with a real opportunity to be much more proactive in starting to predict when people might have issues such as falls, for example, and therefore be able to take preventative measures that stop people from having to engage with acute services in the first place and enables them to be supported to stay in their own homes, which is really important. So I think we've learned a lot in terms of what we've been able to roll out really quickly in the face of a threat, but we've also learned a lot about how quickly we can pull together existing data sources and join them up. And then there are also the opportunities from the testing network that we've developed. So unfortunately, that is still very much live and in use in terms of combating both the old variants and the new variants of COVID. But we're also in the background planning for how we can use that network of infrastructure and how we can use it to support the health of the population going forwards. So some really exciting opportunities there. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Caroline, and to Mary for those responses. And thank you to all of the staff that have done such a magnificent job for us. Thank you. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, and so say all of us. We've got a limited amount of time this morning, and so I've just got a couple of very short final questions. But just to say to Mary and to Caroline, if there are points you feel as though you've not had an opportunity to make that on reflection or you want to make, then please don't hesitate to put something in writing to us to capture anything that you think would be useful in our deliberations. But I just want to turn... I think, Mary, you said in your opening statement about the kind of procurement arrangements and the legal framework and all that, and I think you said it was all back to normal. Obviously, as a public audit committee, we're always concerned to make sure that contract notices are uploaded within the legal framework, that they're published, and they're published within legal timeframes. So I wonder, Mary, could you confirm, almost in a yes or no answer, whether that is now the case?
Yes, it is now the case. We some of our notices were delayed, and that was surely down to volume of work and pressures that placed upon the teams that are there, and the rapidity at which we were doing things. But we are all now completely back into normal ways of working.
Thanks for that. I think, and one of the other things, I think, again, Mary, I think you mentioned in your opening statement, although Caroline Lamb might also have a view on this, was the Louisa Jordan facility, which, of course, was put together in a rapid time frame, and I think was a 300-bed facility with the option of expanding to 1,000 beds. One of the things which just occurs to me as we approach the pressures of winter is what's happened to that equipment? where have those beds gone? Where's the rest of the supporting equipment ended up? I don't know whether Mary or Caroline can answer that question, or both of you.
Yeah, so we maintain an active inventory of all of the equipment and all of the parts, and some of those pieces have been distributed already to hospitals, and some of the items are stored in our additional two warehouses. I'm not sure if Caroline wants to come in and make any further comments in that regard, and if you want further detail specifically around it, Gordon Beattie can let you know exactly what's gone where.
Thank you. Caroline, do you want to come in?
Yeah, absolutely. So, again, you know, absolutely tremendous job done in establishing the Louisa Jordan so quickly. I am hugely grateful that we didn't have to use it for COVID patients. However, it was great to have that facility, and we made enormous use of it for outpatients, for diagnostics, and indeed for the vaccination programme. I think Mary's answered the questions in terms of what's happened to a lot of the equipment. I guess, you know, convener, you would expect me just to remind the committee that actually it's not just all about equipment. We also need to have the staffing to support those beds and that equipment. And we are in the context of running not just a health service that's trying to cope with a lot of backlog and unprecedented demand at our front door, and still running the biggest ever vaccination programme in Scotland with an additional acceleration that's just been announced, then actually staffing is a bit more of a staff. It's staffing that we need to focus on at the moment rather than the equipment. But it's great to have that spare equipment as well.
OK, thank you very much. And on that note, I won't bring in Gordon Beattie, because I think we'll finish on that. I just want to say that I think Caroline Lamb's point is absolutely correct. And one of the things which this committee does concern itself with on a regular basis is workforce planning. And if there are staff shortages or staff issues, then that's something that we are keen to learn about and to encourage organisations to address and keep as a priority, because, as Willie Coffey said, without the staff, the efforts would not have been as monumental as they have been, and will continue to need to be as we look to the future. So can I thank everybody once again for joining us this morning to give us evidence, Mary, Carolyn Gordon from NSS, and Caroline and Richard from the NHS and the Government Directorate. So thank you very much indeed for your time this morning and for your evidence. It's been very helpful to us. And I'd now like to close the public part of this morning's meeting and go into private session. Thank you.